my name is Tony. Director John Borman had a somewhat checkered career. More checkered than a checkerboard on a Czech tablecloth in the Czech Republic. He started out directing a movie featuring a momentarily popular 60s beat band, the Dave Clark Five. Catch Me If You Can sought to replicate the success of the Beatles' Hard Day's Night, but it didn't really. Next up was seminal 60s Lee Marvin Pulse Pounder Point Blank, followed by Hell in the Pacific, again with Marvin, and then Deliverance. Deliverance was the original interbred hillbilly terrorist flick, complete with whitewater rapids, male rape, squealing like a piggy, and crossbow bolts through the neck. And banjos. Don't forget those fucking annoying banjos. A very influential modern classic. Point Blank and Deliverance are two of the best and most artistically creative action movies ever made. Riding high on his successes, Borman promptly flipped his wig. In 1974, after a failed attempt at getting a version of Lord of the Rings into production, he made Zardoz. Now I know it's become something of a cult item, and some sci-fi fans have seen fit to reappraise it in a more positive light, but this doesn't mean it's become any good. For me, it wasn't then, and it isn't now. It's a confused, overindulgent, pretentious, and unsatisfying mess. A thoughtlessly bizarre dystopian stew, drawing inspiration from The Wizard of Oz, T.S. Eliot, and Aldous Huxley. Yes, sure, it has ideas and ambitions, but then so did Heaven's Gate. Yet no matter how hard revisionists and apologists try to sell that as a newly discovered masterpiece or anything other than a genre-butchering cataclysm of apocalyptic proportions, I ain't buying. And it's the same with Zardoz. Besides, the sight of Sean Connery with a ponytail and wearing an early mankini is a major league credibility destroyer and something my eyes and those of the world at large should have been mercifully spared. But that means little or nothing in comparison with what came next. In 1977, Borman gave the world what I consider to be the worst mainstream Hollywood movie ever made, Exorcist II: The Heretic. In fact, it's a contender for worst movie of all time across the board. If we consider that The Exorcist was indeed a trailblazing masterpiece of technical, intellectual, and emotional style and content, take all that and reverse it completely, and Exorcist II: The Heretic is what you've got. You know, I sometimes toy with the idea of reviewing Zardoz and imagine that one day I'll actually do it. It's feasible that bolstered by enough alcohol-fueled Dutch courage, I'll hack through it. However, I find Exorcist 2 so terrifyingly bad that the mere thought of having to watch it again or address it in any detail makes me want to shoot myself in the face. Avoidance, you cry. Yep. Damn fucking right it is. There is no way I'm going anywhere near it. Not now, not ever. And if anyone out there hasn't seen it and might think I'm exaggerating or overreacting, and as a result feels they'd like to judge for themselves, then I do understand that. But in all conscience, I would beg you, for your own sake, don't fucking do it, Pilgrim. On this one issue, just take my word for it. Okay, I've done my duty, I can do no more. You still go ahead? Then don't say I didn't warn you. The only way you'd get me to watch it again is if you strap me in a clockwork orange brainwashing rig complete with high tensile eyelid clamps and a self-charging cattle prod in automatic fire mode shoved up my arse to keep me conscious. That's all I'm saying. Anyway, it was 4 years before Borman could be trusted to make another movie. By the time of Excalibur in 1981, had he calmed down and composed himself any? Well, to some degree. Seems he had a vision of the type of film he wanted to make, and if the finished article is anything to go by, he wanted to make a hallucinogenic pantomime based on Arthurian legend that was full of dreamlike spectacle and super eccentric trappings, and that's exactly what he achieved. He sticks to the tried and tested mythological storyline depicted in the 15th century text Le Morte d'Arthur by Thomas Malory and a few other arcane works. It's the Dark Ages, and things are, well, pretty fucking dark. King Uther Pendragon, supported by Merlin, his confidant and magician, wages war on the Duke of Cornwall. A truce is called, but war breaks out again when Pendragon decides he wants to rumble with Cornwall's wife, Igraine. Merlin agrees to cast a spell to facilitate this and orchestrate Cornwall's death, but in return he wants Uther to grant him whatever issues from your lust. What issues from his lust is a kid called Arthur, whom Merlin takes into guardianship whilst Uther gets ambushed by his enemies and before dying plants the Sword of Kings Excalibur in a big lump of rock. Years later, as I'm sure most of you will know, Arthur yanks the sword from the stone, becomes the true king, brings peace and prosperity to the land, builds Camelot, and founds the Knights of the Round Table. Arthur marries Guinevere, a knight called Lancelot turns up, and eventually starts lancing Guinevere a lot. And Cornwall's daughter and Arthur's half-sister Morgana, who is as powerful a mage as Merlin, seeks revenge for the death of her father. The realm is plunged into turmoil, Lancelot and Guinevere are banished for their shagathon in the woods, Morgana imprisons Merlin and casts a spell on Arthur, raping him and becoming pregnant as a result. She gives birth to a nasty little golden-haired git, Mordred, and the country declines further into famine and plague. Arthur sends his knights on a quest to find the Holy Grail and thus restore balance, and Mordred grows up to demand the throne. The scene is set for a climactic showdown between the forces of good and evil, just like it always is. That's about it, so how does it all fly? Borman enthusiastically creates a striking and stylized medieval world balanced at the tipping point, where the old ways of pagan magic and mysticism are crumbling away under the advent of Christianity. Visually, he crafts a vivid tapestry of dirt, mud, blood, guts, gore, and bold knights clad in pristine, gleaming, highly polished suits of silver armor. It's a heady and attractive mix, with some crunching combat sequences of jousting and lumbering hack-and-slash swordplay. You can almost feel the devastating impact of every blow landed, the screaming anguish of every limb severed. He tells a timeless and enduring story, which isn't broke, so doesn't need fixing, and I like that about it. But, and as Oprah would no doubt say, it's a big but I am going to Weight Watchers, it does suffer at the hands of some odd choices and allowances. Arthur is played by Nigel Terry. Yeah, right, who the fuck is he? He was a British stage actor who had a Spartan movie-making history and a lot of TV bit part roles prior to Excalibur. Post-Excalibur, this situation didn't change. His one stab at the big time, but it didn't really leave. Anyway. Something of an odd choice then. He starts out looking like some faintly goofy country yokel, but at least when he grows his hair and a beard, he looks a bit more Arthurian. Best value for money is Nicol Williamson as Merlin. With his silver skull cap and towering presence, he resembles a sci-fi villain from Flash Gordon or Star Trek. His adopted accents and dialects inexplicably travel the length and breadth of the British Isles. He's Irish, Welsh, Cornish, West Country, and at times has a Brummy twang. Sometimes he affects a high-pitched verbal tone, like he's just spontaneously snagged a bollock in the zipper of his codpiece, again for no discernible reason. In truth though, he's quite a dominant figure throughout, and you sort of miss him when he's off-screen. The supporting players are a recognisable bunch, including Liam Neeson, Gabriel Byrne, Patrick Stewart, only 84 when he made this, Corin Redgrave, Clive Swift, and Nicholas Clay. Cherry Lungi is a suitably radiant Guinevere, and Helen Mirren is wickedly beautiful as the scheming incestuous Morgana. Worst thing about it, though, is the dialogue. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. It's fucking atrocious. Absolute doggerel. Written by Borman and Rospo Pallenberg, they must have been sharing one massive tenure for rhythm, literacy and nuance when they worked on the script. Howlingly bad. And it isn't helped by the male actors being very shouty. Was partial deafness a big problem during the Dark Ages? Who knew? Nearly all the men bellow at each other. Add to this an epidemic of overacting and slicing the ham, with the excessive zeal of a gang of ravenous carnivores emerging from a pig drought, and you get characterizations that are certainly larger than life, but often very little like it. There's an intriguing but puzzling scene when Arthur visits Guinevere in the nunnery where she has retreated. He retrieves Excalibur, which he discarded and she kept, and he speaks to her with an American accent. I'd ask why, but I doubt I'll get an answer. It's a bit odd though. I mean, I'm pretty sure at the time in which this film is set, America sort of didn't exist. Answers on a postcard, anyone. Lungi and Mirren are the most restrained performers on board, and both shine quite impressively. And although I perhaps shouldn't say it for fear of provoking the feministas, they look transcendently gorgeous and resolutely feminine. There's another thing that impacts adversely on Excalibur for me, and it's nothing to do with the film as such, it's a personal thing. I'm not able to bypass memories of Monty Python and the Holy Grail whenever I watch it. Every time a limb is severed, I think of the Black Knight. It's only a scratch. When Lancelot rocks up again at the end, bedraggled long hair and scraggly beard, he looks just like a Monty Python character. Each time the action moves to Camelot on the Round Table, the Camelot song plays in my mind. I can't help it. Sorry, my cross to bear. Excalibur can be incoherent and befuddled, confusing and a little oversaturated with mystical and religious symbolism, but it's never less than entertaining. In its own way, it's a fascinating and compulsive piece of cinema, a sword and sorcery mini-epic that raises the bar for such fantasy films. With a better year for dialogue and a director who thought to instill a little more thespian subtlety and nuance in the cast, it might have been as essential a genre-defining piece as Deliverance. However, it feels like Borman was so fired up by the the subject matter, it had been a lifelong dream project for him. He focused more on the style and philosophy of the thing than the nuts and bolts substance of articulate filmmaking. Despite this cutting its own groove, it's a unique take that certainly has a powerful way of captivating and drawing the viewer into its world. It's apparently got the dubious honour of being Zack Snyder's favourite film. Oh yeah? Wonder what he learned from it. Hey, thanks again for your time and attention. I'm continuing to enjoy the nostalgic buzz I get from putting this stuff together, and I hope that someone out there is getting something out of it too. If you are, please feel free to hit like, don't like, leave a comment, or subscribe. If you're not getting anything out of it, last thing you should do is expect me to care. I will return. Threat of the Decade. Catch you soon, pilgrims.